nice to see everyone here tonight. It's good to have you. A beautiful evening here. It's glad to be able to be together. So I have a question. Does anybody here like baseball? Anybody like baseball? Baseball fans? Yeah. Baseball in the house. All right. Well, it's baseball season at our house. I'll be honest, I do not follow any of the professional teams. You'll have to ask my husband about that if you want to talk about that. But I do follow a few first and second grade teams. I've always enjoyed playing ball, and I started my three boys in baseball this spring, which led to me being asked to coach for the older two for coach pitch, which means I have to pitch. I'm not a pitcher. So that was really fun. It has been really fun. And Pastor Larry did a whole series for me this spring about anxiety. So that was really great timing for that. But it's going okay. We're actually down to our last two games coming up this week. I'm very excited about that. Happy to have this group of kids to work with, kind of building this team and teaching them how to work together. Also happy to have a little break coming up. So that's nice. I see all these posts on social media, you know, proud parents and their kids with their trophies and talking about their winning seasons. And my first coaching season is not a winning season, but that's okay. but as I was thinking about our devotional tonight, and I was thinking about our day at the ball field yesterday, I wasn't thinking about winning. I was thinking more about perseverance and kind of how far we've come in this little team in the short time I've had with them. A parent from the opposing team came up to me after the game yesterday, and they told me they thought I was doing a great job with the kids and kind of was trying to be encouraging. I laughed a little because technically we don't really keep track of wins and losses in coach pitch, but we were losing by a lot. But they were generally trying to encourage me and our team, and I told them, you know, two of my kids actually got their first hit of the season yesterday, so I counted that as a win, and you know, they wholeheartedly agreed with me and were trying to make this kind gesture, and I appreciated that. And the thought of those kids working so hard all season to finally get their hits kind of made me think of a few verses that often came to my mind during my own student-athlete career. In Romans 5, I thought of these words, where Paul tells us, "Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our suffering, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us." Now, I don't think Paul was talking about baseball here, but I saw some parallels. And suffering is subjective, but if you ask my 4-year-old over there, he would probably say mommy making him stand on the field the whole game would be suffering. But the idea is you work through the hard stuff to get to the good stuff, right? I always thought that I was a little biased as an athlete and that I would see themes of team and sports references in scriptures because it made sense to me. I understood how you work and you grow, and growing is hard and difficult and can be painful, but that's how you develop as an athlete, and that made sense to me. And it was easy for me to draw parallels that I could understand in my faith journey as well. However, as I'm drawn back to familiar scriptures, I see a fresh parallel that didn't dawn on me in high school or college. I see the church, the people of Christ, as being called to come together as a team. In Hebrews 10, we are reminded, "Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful, and let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are prone to do, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." There's so much in these passages that we could delve into, but one of the things that really caught my eye is kind of the references to hope and this idea of hope. And hope has been sorely needed this last year, hasn't it? Hope for something better. Suffering has been at the forefront of people's lives and minds like never before, at least in my lifetime. And man, did we really have to dig deep to persevere through all of that, to hold on to our hope, because we are a people of hope. But what this year has really taught us, I hope more than anything else, is that we cannot do it alone. Let us not give up meeting together. Wow, I will never take meeting together for granted again. And how much we need that connection and this community to work through this life as a team. So that we may encourage one another, let's cheer each other on when it gets tough. Let's help each other out. Let's solve problems together. That's what being a team is all about. I believe as Christians we are called to be on the same team, working together for Christ. But it does not come naturally, as I have discovered as you watch the littlest humans among us. We have to work at it, and we have to listen to our coach. As I have coached these first and second graders, I've learned that they have absolutely no idea how to work as a team. Who covers the base? Who gets the ball? Sometimes two or three kids are on the same base and you don't know who to throw to. Sometimes two or three kids are wrestling on the ground for the ball because they don't know who's supposed to get it or how to figure that out. Sometimes you watch two of them, whoops, there goes the ball, and I'm like, somebody go get it. It's closer to him. You know, they don't understand that idea of working together and how to make that work. They have to learn each other's strengths and weaknesses. In the same manner, we have to come together as the church and work as a team to encourage each other during times of suffering and to help hold on to the hope of our faith. Working as a team is certainly not always easy. It takes commitment both to show up to practice, but also to be willing to put the individual work in so that we may be mentally prepared on game day, right? For example, Christopher, my four-year-old again, poor guy, he did not get his nap before T-ball yesterday in the afternoon, so he did not want to go play on the field. I would like to say that I just gave him a good heart-to-heart and taught him this great lesson about being a team player and supporting your team, but really he went out on the field because I told him I would eat his ice cream if he did not. So we're working on that. But when my husband and I are arguing, for example, sometimes Ricky realizes what's happening, and I have to give him credit here in the wisdom he's developed over our years together. Sometimes in the midst of my emotional tirade, he will look at me and he will say so calmly, "Ashley, I am on your team." And that works every time. He should use this every time, honestly. It always works, I swear, because when he says that, I hear so many things. He's telling me, he's reaching out an olive branch to me. He's saying he's trying to help me. He's saying he's on my side, and he's willing to work alongside me to make things better. He's reminding me that I shouldn't be working against him, that we have the same goals, and that we should be working together. And in the same way, this idea of team is what the church should be. So let us encourage one another, holding on to the hope that we have been given, and let us thankfully continue meeting together.